Church, how are you? Are you excited to be in the house of God? Come on, will you join us? We worship you, Lord.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more.
Come on.
Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Oh,
for God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Oh, come on, sing.
And praise him for the wonders of his love.
Praise God, sing. Praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him. Praise him for the wonders of his love. His amazing love.
For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Through every battle, through every heart, every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. Oh, I believe you are the way, the truth, the
truth, the light.
and it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you, and you meet me here today with mercies that are new, and all my fears and doubts, yeah, they can all come to.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh. Worthy in every song we could ever sing. Worthy than all the praise we can ever bring. Worthy than every breath we can ever breathe. We live for you, oh Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other names. Jesus, the only one we could never say. Worthy than every breath we can ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy. Holy, there is no one like you. There is one beside you. Open up my eyes. Show me. song we can ever sing. Worthy than all the praise we can ever bring. Worthy than every breath we can ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other names. Woo! Jesus, the only one we can ever say. Worthy in every breath we can ever breathe. We live for you. is no one. There is no one. Open all my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love. One more time, church. One more time. Oh, only
there is no one.
Come on. There is no one.
lives is your Jesus. We love you, Jesus. I love you, Father.
Hallelujah. Open my eyes and wonder, God. Open my eyes that we might see today, no matter where we are, what we're going through, that as we're talking about this month, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And this week, had opportunity to stand at the bedside of those gravely ill and just wonder what's going to happen. But trusting in Jesus, and then see as the week goes by, improvement, and God making a way, and God just doing his thing. Open our eyes, God, to what the potential is, what you can do. And there are those this morning that have lost loved ones, and you're grieving, but Jesus is the way. He's the firm foundation. He is the resurrection and the life. And yesterday I had a chance to walk Sonoma Boulevard and just tell people about Jesus. And I have folks that just have their life as a train wreck, but it doesn't matter what we're going through. Jesus is still the way. He's still the truth. He's still the life. He's the one that we can build a firm foundation on. So this morning, no matter what you're going through, would you just lift your hands to God right now and say, God, show me in my situation. God, show me what I'm going through. God, show me that I can build on you. You are a firm foundation. God, you are the way. You are the truth. You are the life. I will build my life on you because you, God, will hold me up. Come on, let's worship the Lord this morning. Hallelujah! Jesus!
I will never be shaken. Come on, declare, declare. Come on, come on, come on.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord praise this morning. Hallelujah. 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 Now this morning, before we sit down, before we move on, if you need God to show you, you're going through something this morning, I want you just to lift up your hand. Lift it up. Lift up your hand right now. And I want others around you, just, you may be standing behind someone or next to someone with their hand raised. Would you just put your hand on their shoulder right now? Right now, just reach out, reach out. Because we just sang, Lord, show me to share the love with others around me. We just sung that. Let's do it. Let's do it. So, Father, right in this room, we proclaim that you are a firm foundation. There is none like you. And we say with the angels, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. God, reveal your glory today. God, we pray that you would show your love, show up in these circumstances, these situations. God, you know exactly what you're doing. You know exactly what they need. And so with the assurance and the comfort and the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray right now God, you would bring healing and deliverance. God, you would bring renewal. Father, you'd bring hope. Lord, do what you have ordained by your will, perfectly crafted for each and every situation. As we release it to you, we surrender it to you, God, letting you be God. Thank you, Jesus. And we bless you today. We thank you for what you've already done, and we thank you for what you're about to do. And we give you the praise. We give you the honor. And we give you the glory. For we ask these things in the precious name of Jesus. In the precious name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God a hand praise this morning. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, God, this morning. Thank you, Father. Thank you for loving us like no one else can. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, say amen. All right, high five somebody around you. Welcome them here this morning. Tell them you're glad that they showed up today, because something good is happening at the Hill Vallejo. God bless you. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. I'm Pastor Scott. If we haven't had a chance to meet, we want to welcome you here today. If this is your first time here, we have a guest services desk out in the hallway, and we encourage you to visit. Stop by. We'd love to meet you. Got a gift there for you. And just love to say hi. Amen. Those that are watching us online, our online campus, get in that conversation with our online campus pastor. We'd love to get to know you as well. Thanks for joining us here this morning. You know, a big part of the Hill is outreach. Big part of what we do. We want to reach the lives of people all around us. Amen. We're reaching people here in this city, but as you know, this church and our whole fellowship, we're just about, you know, God's desire for every single person to come to know his love. And so one of the ways we're reaching out, as many of you are familiar with, is through a group called Open Arms. Open Arms' motto, their vision is to keep families together. They have three campuses just on the Baja of Mexico. Anyway, it's down there south of the border. And they're doing a fantastic job on their three campuses. They've church, daycare, they've just so many outreach programs for their ministry to the areas around them. And one of the major things that they do, as most of you know, one of the major things they do is they provide daycare for families who have to work. Many of the parents are working in the fields, and so they either leave the kids alone, and that's dangerous, or they bring them to Open Arms. And just recently, just this last week, we heard a story about a young lady named Mia. Mia was being raised by a single mom. She was brought to Open Arms when she was 11 years old, her and her brother. And Mia was depressed, and she was suicidal. And, you know, Pastor Fye's been talking to us about things people go through, and one of the main Sundays in this series was dealing with suicide and suicide prevention. And this young lady named Mia, she was suicidal, but through her time at Open Arms over the last 6 or 7 years, God has delivered her, God has saved her, God has helped her see her worth and value in him. And she recently graduated from college from high school this past June. And you know what? She was number one in her class. She was valedictorian in her class. And we're just so thankful that we can partner with groups like this. And through your giving, that's what we're doing. So when you give, you're investing. Amen. It's an investment. And so as you're investing today with your tithes and offerings and your missions giving, remember that Open Arms is near the top of the list of our first and foremost in our missions family. We really have a heart for them. And how many of you know there was a hurricane that went through the part of Mexico, the Baja, Mexico? They had a hurricane in the Baja. And it went through, and it really did a number on four of their buildings, took the roof off. So we're going to put together a team of people, go down October 27th, and try to do some repairs. But here's some pictures of that Luke and Katie sent us. Now, Luke and Katie are our youth ministers here, our student ministries pastor here, right? Well, one of the ways you're investing is we sent them down there because they're so great with video. They're so great. They were just so talented. We sent them down to Open Arms, and they're putting together this weekend a new video, promotional video for the ministry. They haven't had one for years. In fact, Pastor Daniel told me on the phone the other day, he said, we are the first church to ever send a team down there to do that in their whole 17-year history. First time they've had a video group come down to just display, and so we can get the word out about Open Arms. So Luke sent me, he climbed up on the roof yesterday and he sent me these pictures. That's one of them. There's another building that's, and this is only one of the buildings, and they're huge and there's lots to do. So if you'd like to come with us, talk to me about it or send an email to info@thehillvallejo.com. It's going to cost about $25,000, $30,000 just to do those roofs, and there's a lot more to do. But we got to do it before the winter rains, because when the hurricane came through, the buildings flooded. So there's a lot to do. So however you choose to get involved, we would welcome you to do that. Now, here at the Hill, there's four ways that you can give. There's boxes on the wall that you can put your offerings in, or perhaps the best and most convenient way is to do it through our app or through PushPay. You can mail it in or bring your offering in, but whatever you do, remember that you are investing in the lives of people like Mia and so many others, and here in this city, God is doing a great thing. Amen? Can I get an amen this morning? So before Pastor Fi comes today, I want to also remind you that it's not too late to sign up for our community groups. We worship in rows, but we want to learn in circles, and we want to get to know each other. And so we gather in circles in what we call community groups. And there's groups for all ages and every stage of life. We have groups. We have a marriage roundtable at 11 o'clock this morning. We have ladies' groups, men's groups, kids' groups. We have everything. Go on our app. You can find out more about it. But it's not too late to sign up. We'd love to have you be part of growing in community here at the Hill. So would you welcome, as we now change our directs a little bit, go to Pastor Fi for the final in our series. This is He Is.
Look at that. How about now? Can you hear me now? We're going to get this right today. All the way from Baja California to Northern California, it's going to be a good day. Oh, God is good. You know, sometimes we take ourselves too seriously, right? Like, it's good to laugh. It's good to enjoy each other's company. It's good to be together, to worship together, and to just share and open God's word together. And today, as Pastor Scott mentioned, we're finishing this series, He Is. If this is the first time you're like, it's getting finished, I just got here, I'm going to catch you up here in just a moment with where we've been over the last couple of weeks. But ultimately, what we wanted to do this month was take a look at the words that Jesus spoke about himself. And the reason we wanted to look at the words that Jesus spoke about himself is because there's so many people that try to tell us different things about who Jesus is, but I would rather look to what Jesus had to say about himself to understand who Jesus actually is. It's important for us to actually take time to look at the words of Jesus, and if Jesus said it and we say that we are followers of Jesus, it's important for us to pay attention to what he has to say and look at the implications of his words. And so as we found that something to do, we looked at one statement, literally just one statement all month, at what it was that Jesus had to say about himself. And just before he is getting ready to be arrested and go to the cross, he's speaking with his disciples and he's comforting them because he's telling them that in just a little while, they aren't going to see him any longer because he is going to be returning to the Father. And the disciples who had walked with him for several years got a little bit concerned and they were sad in their hearts because he was no longer going to be with them. And he gives them words of comfort. And some of these words of comfort are actually this statement that he makes telling us about himself. Because when you know something about somebody, you can take comfort in that. And here's the statement that he said in John chapter 14, verse 6. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This one seemingly simple sentence, this one seemingly quiet word that was spoken to a group of people is a weighty statement that when we look at it in its fullness, we can truly see who Jesus is and what he has to say about himself. And we too can take comfort knowing who our Jesus is. It's important for us to take comfort in the real Jesus, not in the Jesus that somebody maybe has a bad perception about, but the real Jesus. Let's take comfort in who Jesus really is. And so this first week, Pastor Scott kicked this whole idea and thought off by taking those first two words that Jesus spoke, three letters that literally change everything. Jesus said, I am. And when he says, I am, he's basically saying, I am God. I am the one that you have been looking for. I'm the one that you have been waiting for. I am him. I am the Messiah. It is me. And when he spoke that in context, it caught people off guard because no one could claim to be God, because if they did, it was blasphemous. And that was one of the things that those that were around him had against Jesus, is that they said, you can't say that about yourself. But yet Jesus would say it time and time again, I am. And he would say, I am this and I am this. And this month as we looked, he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. And in the second week, we looked at the last part of that statement where Jesus says, I am the life. And we shared with you this idea that life is something that is so important and so valuable. But life, true life, the full life that we were all intended to have is only found in Jesus. And there is a generation that is facing a crisis where they have lost hope and they have found themselves lonely to the point where they are giving up on life. And our hope is that we, as we partner with organizations like Stay Here, which you'll hear more about in the coming weeks, that we will partner with people who are going into the hard places and talking to people who have found themselves hopeless and telling them about the life that is found in Jesus, but they, in order to find that life, they have to stay alive. And so fullness of life is found in the one who created life. Fullness of life is found in the one who sustains our life. Fullness of life is found in the one who holds us all together. And he doesn't just give us life and hope for a life eternally, but he gives us hope for a life that would begin fully here today. And last week we looked at the second part of that statement where Jesus says, I am the way. And when he says, I am the way, ultimately what he is saying is, I am the path that you must take. That if you want to find the Father, if you want to reach the destination of knowing who the Father is, you have to follow my way. And we looked at what is Jesus' way, but Jesus' way is a way of surrender. It's a way of saying, God, you know more than I do. You know better than I do. And so I will surrender my life to you. And the only way that I can learn to surrender my life to you is if I follow the way of Jesus. And Jesus found himself in a place of surrender by constantly finding himself in prayer, spending time with the Father, communing with him. And if we are going to learn to surrender our lives, we are going to have to learn to spend time with God and being able to sit and listen to what he has to say. And when he says something that maybe is a little bit hard for us, that we can come to the place like Jesus came and he says, but Father, not my will, but your will be done. Because there are so many places in our life, I know there's places in mine where I have to constantly say, God, not my way, but your way. God, you know better. You are the one. You are the author and the finisher of my faith. You go before me. So God, not my way, but your way. And so today we want to look at that last part of the statement that we haven't looked at. And it's the statement that, the part of the statement that honestly, if we look at this word that we're about to look at today, is one that has come under attack. It's a word that has that causes a lot of friction, that even causes division. It's a word that if we don't tread with it carefully, can even hurt people. Jesus says, I am the truth. When we talk about truth, especially lately, oftentimes what we hear is this: well, your truth isn't necessarily my truth. And we even hear people say things like this: what is true for you may not be true for me. And what is true for you may not be true for someone else on the other side of this conversation that we're having. But if we're honest and we look at the word, if something is true, it's got to be true. If something is true, it can't be relatively true. It just has to be true. And if it's true, and it's if it's actual truth, then it stands up on its own. And if it's truth, it will be proven. And if it's true, it doesn't matter where we are, it's always going to be true. And so here is Jesus making this statement that he is the truth, not just a truth, but the truth. He doesn't say, I'm one of many truths. He says, I am the truth. And that statement and that part of the statement sometimes will cause us to sit back in our chairs a little bit. And sometimes will cause us in a place like where we live today, in 2023, it will cause us to have conversations maybe that we weren't prepared to have. Or maybe will cause us to have conversations that will lead to division. And again, if we aren't careful with this word truth, we can honestly hurt people rather than help people. Because the truth, though it is always true, when used incorrectly, causes more harm than it does good. And I'll show you how in just a moment. And see, I don't have problems with truth. I have no problems telling the truth once I learned that lying was not good. As a child, not as an adult, as a child. It isn't truth that's the problem, but it's the words and the actions that we use to present and convey the truth that are the problem. Several years ago, I had an opportunity to go to the New York Stock Exchange. And while I was pastoring, but before I stepped into full-time ministry, I worked in financial services for about 20 years, and I held a stock broker's license, and I was offered a trip to go actually walk and stand in the New York Stock Exchange. And I was like, that's a trip of a lifetime, sure. One of the things that Cheryl and I have kind of lived our lives by is if we can afford it, and it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing, you better just go do it and find a way to make it happen, which is why I've told you over the last several weeks that when Pastor Scott and Betsy kept telling us, you have to come to Israel, that was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that we said we've got to go, and it turned into that it's not going to be just once in a lifetime because we got to go back there because it was so incredible. And if you haven't signed up, it's not too late. You can sign up. You should go. But we got to walk on the New York Stock Exchange. We got to see how they did things, and we got to see people placing orders and see what it was that was going on the stock exchange. It was kind of a quiet day, so it wasn't super loud like normally you would see the stock exchange to be. But we walked around the floor, and we hung out, and when we were done, we left the building, and we walked out, and around the New York Stock Exchange building, there's a bunch of other federal buildings that are in that area. One of them is where they print money and a bunch of different things that were going on over there. And as I was walking by, I saw somewhat of a commotion. And, you know, you see a commotion, you want to see what's going on, right? And so I saw this man who was standing at the just outside of the stock exchange, and he was yelling, and there was people that were walking by. And when they would walk by, they kind of had a disgusted face. And I was like, I got to see what's happening. Why are they so upset? And this man was yelling, and he had a cardboard sign. And I heard somebody say, oh, Lord. He had a cardboard sign, and he was screaming. And do you want to know what this sign said? He's holding this sign up, and the sign said, you are going to hell. And he was yelling that at the top of his lungs. And I walked by and I was like, well, now I understand why everybody's walking by him and they're kind of disgusted and they're upset. But I walked by and I had to kind of see what else was happening, because you don't just hold a sign like that and not say anything else. But he repeated that statement for just a little bit of time, and then he would start to just speak, and he would yell at people as they would pass by and tell them about how horrible they were and how they were going to hell. And I stopped for a moment and I was like, well, that's not very nice, number one. And secondly, as I was standing there, I just got to wonder about all of the people that were walking by there and how that spoke to them and what it actually spoke to them. Because if we're honest and we're true and we look at life, and many of us who maybe have just come to know Jesus, it means that we've come to step out of our sin and we've stepped out of the things that God has delivered us from. But there are many people that don't know who Jesus is, and we believe there is a heaven and there is a hell. And we do believe that when you reject Jesus, that that leads you to a place that you and I were never created to go to. And so while what he was saying could have potentially for some people been true, that statement and the way that it was conveyed actually did more harm than it did good. And though it might have been true for some, what it did was turn people away, that somebody that maybe was walking out that day that had a hard time at work didn't need to hear, you're going to hell. They needed to hear, did you know that there is a God that loves you? That doesn't want to see you in your brokenness, but wants to transform your life. And that, in that moment, could have been much more helpful than telling somebody that they were going to hell. And yet he screamed it, and he continued to scream it, and I just walked away thinking, is there a better way? Have you ever encountered someone trying to tell you something that was true, but though it was true for you and where you were, it did more harm than it did good? I found myself in a place as a teenager where unfortunately somebody spoke truth to me, and it was true, but what it did was set me back rather than push me closer to the Father. And though the intent in reality was to push me closer to Jesus, what it did was push me farther away, because all I saw was how horrible I was. And how I wasn't good enough. And while in of itself that statement and those things were technically true, what I needed in that moment was somebody to put their arm around me and tell me, look, God doesn't want to see you like this. God wants to see you healed and delivered and set free. He wants you to walk in the freedom that Jesus came to die for you for. And what you are doing is leading you to things that you aren't supposed to be dealing with. But instead, what I heard was shame and guilt. And it's not that what they were saying wasn't true. It was just what they used to tell me the truth. Maybe you found yourself in a similar place where you've been hurt by somebody telling you the truth. Today, I believe Jesus wants to set us free from that. And he wants to show us that when he says that he is the truth, he is actually giving us a way that we can build and stand our life upon him. Just before Jesus was arrested, we read the statement where he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And he knows he's getting ready to be crucified. And he's spending these very last few moments that he has with his friends. And he's telling them, listen, I am the way, the truth, and the life. But I also need to teach you some more, because there's so much more that I need to tell you. And he begins to tell them that if they will abide in him, they'll have life. And then he begins to not only teach them, but he begins to pray over them and pray over those who would come to know him through their testimony of him. And we find in John 17, Jesus' words and his prayer as he's getting ready to go to the Father. He prays for his disciples, and here's what he says in verse 13. He says, I'm coming to you now, speaking to the Father. He's in prayer. He says, but I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. And look at verse 17. He says, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. I don't believe that Jesus is a waster of words, especially in the last few moments of his life. I don't believe that he was one that wasted the words that he spoke. And if you look at verse 17, what he says is, he says, sanctify them by your truth. And then he pauses and says, your word is truth. That original word that is used is the word logos. Logos is a word that was used to describe who Jesus was when it says, in the beginning was the word. In the beginning was Jesus. And so Jesus is ultimately telling them, and he's in his prayer, he is, what he is saying is, I am the truth. And not only am I the truth, but every word that I have spoken is the truth. And every word that has been collected and gathered as inspired by the Holy Spirit, by the prophets and the disciples that have gone before us, the words that have been captured in this word are his truth. His word is truth. And so what he is saying is, look, if you are looking at how to build your life, if you're looking for how to have a firm foundation, if you want to know what it is that you need to have truth in your life, and not just a truth, but the truth in your life, God, I need you to sanctify them by the truth of your word. And here's the implication for us. It means that you and I not only must surrender to God by spending time with him in prayer, but you and I must spend time with his word, because this is the word that is going to hold true. This is the word that is going to stand the test of time. This is the word that, when things try to go crazy in our world, when circumstances try to tell us something different, this word is what is going to stand firm. It's this word. But oftentimes this word is what gets neglected, and oftentimes the reason why we find ourselves saying things to people, telling them the truth about themselves, or telling them things that they need to hear, we tell them from our perspective rather than the perspective of the true word of God. Paul says in Ephesians 4, he says that we need to be mature and speak the truth in love. But many of us have heard the truth spoken in anger. Or many of us have heard the truth spoken in a way that wants to be proven right. You ever been in an argument before and you knew you were right, and being right was more important than saving the relationship with people? You ever been there? And yet Paul says that we must learn to speak the truth in love. Sometimes being right isn't all that. But what is worth it is founding ourselves in the truth of God's word. Listen to what I'm saying and listen to what I'm not saying. What I am saying is that when we speak the truth in love, I am not saying that we are to be soft Christians. But what I am saying is that we need to learn to live our lives and find our principles upon the truth of God's word and stand true to what it says, even when things are hard. And when we come to meet people who are going through difficult times in their lives, who need to be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are not the Holy Spirit to go beat them up with the word. But we are to open the word with them and put our arm around them and love them and speak truth over them and tell them that God does not want them to remain broken, but he wants them to be free. And I can prove it, because Jesus came even while I was still a sinner, and he died for me. Even at my worst, Jesus loved me where I was. He didn't look at me and point his finger at me, because when was the last time that someone pointed their finger at you and you wanted to follow them? When was the last time that you had somebody point their finger at you and tell you how bad you were and how bad you were doing something, and you said, man, I just want to follow you. You're just telling the truth. And in contrast, when was the last time you were going through something in your life and somebody came and sat with you and listened to you and let you talk and didn't have an answer for you before you were done talking, but listened to you where you truly were And when you were done, they still loved you. And they still put their arm around you. And they weren't afraid of you because they knew the truth of who God is. They knew the truth of what God's word says. And they encouraged you with scripture. And they loved you even when you were like, nah, I don't believe that's true. But you still showed up for them. And you still continued to speak the truth in love to them. You still stood firm on the principles that are found in God's word because God's word is the only truth that we need. And you stood firm on that and you loved them. When was the last time you said, you know what, I could follow you? Because you're speaking the truth, and yet the truth is not coming at me like a baseball bat trying to tell me how bad I am. But your truth is trying to really see me free. Psalm 119, 160. The psalmist says this: all your words are true, and all your righteous laws are eternal. God's word will stand firm. It doesn't matter what generation we find ourselves in. It doesn't matter what place we find the world in. God's words are eternal, and they will always prove to be true. God's word is what will lead us. God's word is a lamp to our feet. God's word is what will guide us. God's word is what will direct us. God's word is what will help us when we find ourselves in places where everything seems upside down. It is God's word that will hold us true. Why? Because God's word is what God has chosen to reveal his son Jesus to us by. And when we know what God's word says about Jesus, and we know what God's word says about life, and we know what God's word says about us, that is what we can stand upon. That is the truth. Not a truth, the truth. But this is not something to beat people up with. This is something to show people how they can build their lives upon the firm foundation of God's love for them. Because just as Christ died for you while you were a sinner, he died for them too. And the truth of God's word is just as much for you as it is for them. So don't misuse the truth, but use it as something that you build your life upon. And use it as something to show people just how much God loves them and how he wants to transform them, how he wants to see them made new and refreshed. We cannot be people that take the truth of Scripture and beat people up with it. We have to be willing to and learn how to speak to the issues of our time and the times that are to come, stand it firm on the truth of God, not swerving to the right or to the left, and yet still doing it from a place of love. With an intent to heal and restore people that Jesus died to redeem. Not beat them up even more than they already are. And in both situations, God's word remains true. So let's not be soft Christians. Let's be principled Christians. Let's not be people that say we have no source of truth, but let's be people that says, this is our truth. This is what we stand on. And this is what we will use to build our lives upon. And this is what we will use to help people find the transformation that is found only in God's Son through the power of his Holy Spirit. So Jesus said three things. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Jesus is the path. Jesus is the journey. Jesus is our way. We must learn the way of Jesus, and that is a way of surrendering to the will of God in our lives. Jesus said he is the truth, that his words are true. His words can be trusted. His precepts stand from generation to generation. They are eternal. Though the world pass away, his word will never pass away. Jesus is the life. It is in him that we find our life. It is in him that we find the fullness of life, not just a hope for an eternal life, but a life that is full now, free, and set up for what God wants to do through us to bring more people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And today, as we bring this series and our time to a close, I'm going to ask you to stand with me as we come to this conclusion of this series, He Is, and I'm going to ask you just a few questions as we close. And I'm going to ask you to consider these questions for you and where you are and be honest. Sometimes I find that it's a lot easier to be honest when I know that nobody's looking at me. So if you would, close your eyes for just a moment so you can be honest with God, honest with yourself. Maybe you've been struggling with one of these areas in your life. Have you been struggling with surrendering to the way of the Father in your life? Today, Jesus wants to give you a path to follow. Maybe you've been searching for truth, and today Jesus wants to invite you to build your life upon Him and His truth that is eternal, that stands firm, that is proven, that will not pass away. Maybe today you've been struggling with finding your purpose or finding purpose in life in and of itself. Maybe you've come to a place where even you found yourself hopeless. Today, Jesus wants you to know that He is the full life. Not just life to come, but life now and life eternal. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He wants you to know today that He is everything that you need. And if in any of those areas you've been struggling, if any of those areas you found yourself searching, if any of those areas you say, God, I need you to meet me in this specific area, in the journey of my life, in the fullness of life, on building my life upon your words and your truth, today Jesus wants to meet you where you are and let you know He is everything that you need. And if you haven't already today, would you consider accepting the life that He offers you? Would you consider saying, Jesus, today I'm going to surrender. I'm going to recommit myself to your way and your life and your truth. Today, if there's any one of those areas that you are struggling with, if there's any one of those areas that you say, God, I need you to meet me where I am today. Today, I want to pray for you. And I want to invite you to this place up here in the front if you'd like. There's nothing special about it other than just saying, you know what, it's a way that I'm choosing to surrender today to God your way. It's open for you. If you'd like to receive prayer, we will have a team here to pray with you. But today, know that when Jesus says He is, He's not lying. He is your way. He is your truth. He is your life. He can be built upon. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, today we come to you. And God, we thank you for Jesus, who didn't just speak words to us, but showed us the way to life. And God, thank you that we can find ourselves and find life to the fullest when we choose to live our life built upon you, because you are a firm foundation. And Lord, today I pray that if there's anyone that's under the sound of my voice who is struggling with knowing that you are the way and struggling with surrendering to your will in their life, God, today I pray that they would choose to lay their way down and follow your way. That they would choose to surrender, that they would choose to find themselves in communion with you, simply taking time with you to pray and to hear your words and to hear your direction, because God, we believe that your direction and your way is better. God, I pray today if there is anybody under the sound of my voice who is struggling with life, purpose, reason, struggling with hopelessness, loneliness, God, today would you meet them where they are and let them know that Jesus came to offer them life and life to the fullest, that there is hope, but it's found in you. And God, today, would you restore their joy? Would you restore their hope? Would you let them know, God, that they can live life to the fullest and that fullness is found in you alone? And Holy Spirit, today, would you remind us, if we've been searching for truth, if we've been looking for something to build our life upon that wouldn't crumble underneath our feet, Holy Spirit, would you let us know today that it is your word that you have divinely inspired that is true, that is we can build our life upon that will not fail. It's your word that stands the test of time. And God, would you help us to take joy in your word, to crave your word, to desire your word. And ultimately what that means is to desire you, Jesus. God, we want more of you. And Lord, today, if there is any one of us who has walked away from your path or who hasn't even taken a step onto your path, would you let us know, God, that you welcome us home? That with open arms you welcome us, that you tell us that you love us, that when you speak the truth to us, God, you speak it to set us free, to heal us, and to deliver us. God, would you let us know that when we are with you, that's where we find our healing. That is where we find our deliverance. That is where we find our wholeness. It's found only in your presence. And so today, God, would you help us to commit ourselves to you in your way? We thank you, Jesus, that you are, and we declare it, the way. You are the truth. You are the life. And more importantly today, we declare that you are the I am. You are God in the flesh, Jesus. And we do not shy away from that. Thank you, Jesus, because we know that what you have done is sufficient for us. And so, Lord, today, meet us where we are. Embrace us with your love, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Listen, this space is open. If you'd like prayer, you need to commit yourself. You say, today I want to follow Jesus. There'll be people here who will pray with you today. You say, I want to recommit. People here that will pray with you. Have a wonderful week. God bless you. We'll see you next week.